Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind. Graphic Audio proudly presents R.A. Salvatore's The Demon Wars Saga. Book 4, Mortalis, Part 3. Narrated by Richard Rowan, with performances by Elizabeth Jernigan, David Coyne, Joe Brack, Mort Shelby, Christopher Graybill, Michael John Casey, Andy Clemence, Stephen Carpenter, Terence Aselford, Michael Glenn, Eric Messner, Nanette Savard, Corey James, Ken Jackson, Tim Getman, Colleen Delaney, Lily Beacon, Jonathan Watkins, James Konacek, Johan Detweiler, Chris Rowan, and Laura Quinn Anderson. It was spring in Hans the Bear, but hardly did it seem like a time of life renewing. Francis leaned heavily on the stone wall of St. Mirabel, needing the support. Beyond his shadow, beyond the window, which was no more than a rectangular opening in the stone, he saw them. Dozens of them, scores of them, hundreds of them. Ghostly figures walking slowly through the morning mist that blanketed the field west of the abbey, huddled under blankets and rags against the chill that still bit hard in the springtime night. So beaten and battered were they, so emaciated, that they seemed like skeletons. This collection of pitiful souls outside the abbey seemed like a gathering of the walking dead. And the brothers of St. Mirabel could do nothing for them. Oh, the monks threw some coins, clothing, blankets, and food, mostly as payment for work performed by the plague-ridden sufferers. On Master Balry's suggestion, Master Makuso had hired the gathered plague victims to plant this year's huge tussy-mussy, a massive flower bed that would continue on and on as far as the victims could plant, that might span the mile of ground fronting St. Mirabel's western wall. Francis watched some of them, those with the strength remaining, laboring along the base of the wall, digging in the ground with rotting fingers. The monk bumped his head against the unyielding stone, not hard, but repeatedly, as if trying to thump the frustrations out of his skull.
What miserable wretches we mortals be.
The words were the opening line to an old verse written by a poet deemed a heretic in the 5th century.
Calvin of Brionnais. Strong words, brother.
Francis noted the one-armed Master Balry, flanked by Father Abbot Agringer.
Fitting words, for who in this time is not considering his own mortality?
Calm, brother. He who believes in God does not fear death. Calvin of Brionnais' words were wrought of fear, not contemplation. He knew that he was a sinner, who faced excommunication by the church for the lies he spread, and thus grew his fear of death and his bitterness towards all things of Bellican. It is well documented.
Master Francis shook his head, then closed his eyes.
What miserable wretches we mortals be, to build our homes in sheltered lee, to build our hopes in sheltered womb, weaving fancies of the tomb. What wretched souls we mortals be, to bask in false epiphany, to see a light so clear, so true, to save us from the fate we rue. Deny the truth before our sight, that worms invade eternal night, that maggots feed within the skin of faithful pure, devoid of sin. Oh, what hopeful children mortals be! Castles in air, grand barges at sea, bed of clouds and angel's song, heavenly feasting eternity long. What mockery made of endless night, that prayer transcends truth and hope denies sight, that all that we know and all that we see is washed away by what we pray must be. So tell me not of eternal soul that flees my coil through worm-bit hole. For when I die, what is left of me? A whisper lost to eternity. I know the tale, brother. And I know too that Mortalis was considered a work of great introspection when Calvin presented it to the brothers of St. Hans in the time of the plague.
The time of contemplation.
It was only when Calvin went out among the people, reciting his dark works, that the church took exception.
Because some things should not be spoken openly.
Brother, you must admit that we are the caretakers of the souls of Corona.
While the bodies rot.
You speak so easily
of... We do what we can. Calvin of Brionair was condemned not for his words, but for rousing the common folk against the church, for preying upon their fears of mortality. That is the challenge before us, to hold the faith of the populace.
A smile grew upon Master Francis's face as he considered those words and the irony behind them.
There is a woman out there among them, one-eyed and horribly scarred on her face and neck, with the rings of plague scars all over her arms. They say she tends the sick tirelessly. I have heard that many of the victims have called out for her beatification on their deathbeds.
I have heard of the woman, and expect that she will be investigated when the time for such tasks arrives.
Even your canonization of Brother Avalon has been put off.
Francis didn't even bother to spout the retort that came immediately to his lips, that he would hardly consider himself a supporter of Avalon Despres, let alone a sponsor for the wayward brother's canonization.
It has also been whispered that this peasant woman is no friend of the Abelican Church. According to her, we have deserted her and all the other victims of the Rosy Plague. And there is the other rumor that says it was an Abelican brother who wounded her face outside St. Gwendolyn. A brother with a hand that resembles a cat's paw. Would you wager a guess about his identity?
Francis's sarcasm was not lost on the other two, neither of whom were overfond of Marcalo Dianero. Dianero and his brothers repentant, by all reports, were laying waste to southern Hans the Bear, inciting riots, even murdering some unfortunates who did not fit their particular description of a proper Abelican. Even more disconcerting to all the leaders at St. Mirabel was that when Father Abbot Agringare had sent a messenger by ship to Entel to warn Abbot Olin about the brothers repentant and to offer Olin the full backing of the church if he chose to confront them openly, Agringare had received a reply that seemed to condone Brother Truth more than condemn him. The other abbey in Entel, the much smaller St. Rontelmore, had been faithful to the spirit of Agringare's warning, but Olin of Bondebruce had seemed ambivalent at best.
We cannot end their suffering. And all that we might accomplish in trying would be to destroy the last bastions of security against the Rosy Plague. In this time, God alone will choose who is to live and who is to die. Our duty, brother, is to ensure that those who die do not do so without hope, to ensure that those unfortunate victims understand the truth of what awaits them beyond this life, for in that hope they can come to accept their mortality.
So tell me not of eternal soul that flees my coil through worm-bit hole.
Master Francis, I warn you in all sincerity and in all generosity, as your father abbot and as your friend, to guard well your words. Master Bowrai speaks realistically of our role against the Rosy Plague. We are the caretakers of souls more than of bodies.
And the caretakers of hope, perhaps?
Yes.
And when do we stop asking the question of what the populace might believe and begin asking the question of what we honestly believe?
The two brothers looked at Francis curiously.
I know when, and so do you. It will happen to each of us in turn as we contract the plague, perhaps, or come to sense, whatever the cause, that our personal end is near. Only then will we, each of us, honestly confront that greatest of mysteries. Only then will we hear the words of Calvin of Brionair, or like words.
You seem to be confronting them right now.
Because I look out at them, and I wonder at my place in all this. I wonder at the mortality of hiding behind our walls and flower beds. We, the possessors of sacred stones, of hematite, the soul stone of healing. There lies an incongruity, brother, of which I cannot make sense.
Pony, Roger, and Dainsey arrived in Cartonella amid a melange of late spring scents, with mountain laurel and other flowers blooming bright and thick. A cruel irony, Pony thought, for in Palmaris, in all the cities of Hans the Bear to the south, the plague grew thicker by the day, the vibrancy of life dulling under the dark pall, the springtime scents overcome by the smell of rot. All three had been invited by Abbot Browman to stay within St. Precious, and Pony most of all had understood the generosity of that gesture. St. Precious was a veritable fortress now, and not even the new Baron of Palmaris, an arrogant duke named Tetrafel, had been allowed entrance when he had gone to speak with Abbot Browman. But Browman did not forget his friends. Pony believed that Roger and Dainsey would accept the offer. Certainly Dainsey had shown great excitement when Browman had called it out to them through the newly constructed portcullis backing St. Precious's main gate, and in fact, Pony had hoped that her friends would accept, that they at least would become insulated somewhat against the darkness. For her, it was never a question. Something within her recoiled against the thought. She could not run and hide in the Abbey while so many suffered and died. And yet, there was nothing she could do to help them. She had come to painfully realize over the few months she had spent in Palmaris. First Colleen, and then a succession of others had died in her arms. And so many times, Pony knew that she had barely escaped her encounters with the plague with her health intact. After one devastating defeat after another, she wanted only to go back home, to Dundalus. She felt a combination of pleasant surprise and trepidation when Roger and Dainsey had opted to go north, though only as far as Cartanella, rather than retreating into the Abbey. They found that the plague had not come strong into Cartanella, though one man had contracted it and had died out in the forest somewhere. For he'd understood his responsibility to the community when the rosy spots appeared, and had walked away into the wilderness to die alone. Colleen's house was still deserted, and so Roger and Dainsey, with a blessing of Janine of the Lake and the other town leaders, claimed it as their own. Soon after they had settled into the place, Pony became restless for the road home.
You are certain you will not come to Dundalus with me?
Dainsey has friends here, and so do I. This was my home, and I feel the need to be home, as do you.
But promise that you will return and visit me in Bradwarden.
We'll both go north, perhaps before the end of the season, and in the fall, surely if not before.
That very night, under the cover of darkness, she rode out of Cartanella on Greystone, with Symphony trotting along beside them. She made Dundalus in 5 days on Greystone, for Symphony had run off into the forest to rejoin his herd. His departure reminded Pony of how extraordinary the stallion's arrival beside her on the road south had been. What had brought him to her? How could a horse so perfectly understand the needs of a human being? Perhaps it had something to do with the turquoise gemstone Avalon had put into the horse's breast as a gift to both Elbrine and Symphony, she mused. Or perhaps there had been something special and extraordinary about Symphony even before that. Whatever the case, Pony knew well that had it not been for the stallion, she and Colleen and likely Greystone as well would have died on the road between Cartanella and Palmaris in the snowstorm. Word had reached Dundalus of the Rosy Plague. Pony found herself assaulted by anxious questions from every corner.
Yes, the plague is thick in Palmaris.
The townspeople all backed away from her at that answer, and Pony merely shrugged and rode to Fellowship Way and Belstero Cumley. Pony found that things had not changed much in Dundalus. She found Belster busily wiping the bar, and how his smile widened when he saw her. He rushed around the edge of the bar and wrapped her in a great hug.
But it's good to see you, girl. You must tell me about your adventures.
His smile disappeared, of course, when Pony told him of Colleen. But he managed another smile at the thought of Roger and Dainsey together, for Belster loved both of them dearly.
I thought you dead, girl, when the season turned and you did not return. I feared the weather, or the plague.
Fear the plague, for it grows thicker with each passing day, and none of us, even up here in the Timberlands, are safe from it. And once it has you, I could do nothing for Colleen, but hold her while she died.
Pony went out to the grove that night to be with Albrine, to wonder if he would be there for her when death called to her. After her encounters with the Rosy Plague, Pony was feeling quite vulnerable, and she honestly doubted that she'd find her way through this plague alive. Those grim thoughts held her fast through most of the quiet night, until a familiar song drifted on the evening breeze, the harmony of Bradwarden. So familiar with the forest about Dundalus, so at home out here on a warm night, Pony found her way toward the centaur easily enough.
Warden?
Pony reached into her pouch and sifted through the gemstones Browman had given her, finding a multifaceted, perfectly cut diamond.
Brad Warden! Nox Noctis in Deus.
Pony brought up a tremendous light, filling all the area.
Well, there's a good one for me eyes now, ain't it?
Pony focused on the voice, and finally managed to sort out the silhouette of the centaur's human torso, lurking in the shadows. Pony smiled and decreased the light, and started to move toward Brad Warden, but so did the centaur move, one step away for everyone Pony took toward him. And she sensed immediately that there was something terribly wrong here.
What is it?
20 strides away, that's the rule. Centaur strides and not your little baby human steps.
The plague?
Thick in the south, I'm hearing.
Palmaris is in turmoil. So is Ursel, by all reports.
Dark days indeed. Can't be running to Ada to blow up this enemy.
Pony subtly increased the diamond's light again, trying to get a better view. Concerned suddenly that her friend might not be well.
The plague's not found me.
I do not know that it can affect a centaur.
Oh, but it can. Nearly wiped away me folk time before last. And so we found a rule. 20 strides, not a step closer.
From anyone who has the plague?
To anyone at all. Except the horse, of course. Horses can't catch the damned thing and can't give it to others.
But if someone is not afflicted...
How are you to know? You can't know, can you? You might have it or you might not. You'll not know for sure until you sicken or you don't.
So you are saying that you will not come within 20 centaur strides of anyone at all? Of me?
It's the way it's got to be.
Have you joined the Abelican Church then? They lock their doors and hide in their abbeys while the world outside dies.
And if one of their own gets it, they send him out, not to doubt.
They do. Cowards all.
No. You call them cowards, but I'm thinking them wise indeed. What are they to do then? Come out and die? Wallow in the misery until the misery grows in them?
They could try something. Anything. What right have they to hide themselves away?
Not a right, but a responsibility, I'm guessing. You don't know, my friend. You can't know, for your type of folks don't keep so long a memory. Not long enough, anyway. Do you know the tidings the plague will bring? Do you know the rioting, and the fighting, and the dying?
Pony straightened and stared at him, but had no answer.
Your friends open their abbeys and half of them will die from the plague and do a no good in the process. And the other half will likely die in the fighting, for the folk will blame them monks afore long, don't you doubt. Happened before and will happen again. They'll blame them and they'll burn down their abbeys and they'll stake them up. God's not with them now, they know. And so they'll blame them who think they speak to God.
That set Pony back on her heels a bit, for she realized that she hadn't really considered all the implications here. She hated Brahman's choice, the church's choice, but was there a logical, even necessary reason behind their seeming cowardice? Suddenly, Pony felt very much alone in a very large and dangerous world, a place that had grown beyond her ability to manipulate, even to understand. She looked at her distant friend plaintively.
Play for me.
Aye. That I can do.
To Pony, the quiet, melancholy tune seemed to cry for all the world. Brahman heard the rumble of thunder and thought it curious, for the sky beyond his little window seemed bright and sunny.
Brotherhood! Brotherhood!
Fighting in the streets! Brothers and peasants! Call out the guard! Call out the guard!
Brahman rushed by the frightened young brother, through the corridors of St. Precious, across the inner courtyard, and to the front wall. There he found Talamis and Castinagus on the ramparts, gemstones in hand. Flanking the two were several other brothers, all holding crossbows. Ramenherd scrambled up the ladder to join his friends.
There!
Brother Talamis pointed down a long avenue to a group of about a score of robed brothers hustling toward St. Precious, waving gemstones, a host of peasants pursuing them and flanking them along other avenues.
From St. Mirabel?
Brother Castinagus knew that none of St. Precious's brethren were out of the abbey at that time.
Raise your crossbows!
No!
We'll not kill the folk of Palmaris!
They will overrun the brothers!
No!
Brother Browman noted that Talamis held a graphite gemstone, and he took it from the man and marked the approach.
Open the portcullis and have brothers ready to swing wide the gates!
Master Vicente joined them then, carrying an assortment of stones, graphite among them.
We have to defeat the flanks!
Brahman pointed to the avenue that ended in the courtyard to the left of the abbey.
Kill none, but strike the ground before them to hold them back!
Run, brothers!
Both Brahman and Vicente began falling into their gemstones then, exciting the magical energy. Three lines of people came rushing toward the abbey, the central led by the running brothers, and ones on either side, curling in to seal off their escape into St. Precious. Those flanking lines turned the last corner and began the last run to spill into the courtyard before the gates. Abbot Browman loosed his lightning bolt to the right, followed by Vicente's lesser strike to the left. Browman's bolt struck a building, a farrier shop, rattling the windows and sending several horseshoes flying wildly. Vicente's bolt hit the cobblestones of the road and ricocheted up, catching the leading peasant squarely in the face and hurling them to the ground. Vicente could only pray that he hadn't harmed any too badly.
The doors! The doors!
The front gates of St. Precious swung wide, and Brother Talamis and a dozen other brothers rushed out to escort the line of running brothers into the abbey. They didn't get in easily, though. Talamis and the others had to kick and punch through a group of stubborn peasants. Finally, with several people down and wounded before the gates, and two brothers bleeding badly, St. Precious was secured. From the rampart, Abbot Browman could only watch and shake his head helplessly. He noted a group of city soldiers along the avenue to the right, making no move at all to secure the situation. He wasn't surprised. Brahman went down to the inner courtyard then to greet his unexpected visitors. By the time he arrived, they had pulled back their hoods. Some were being tended for minor wounds, others were simply bent over, trying to catch their breath. Brahman looked them over curiously, for though many were not young men, he didn't recognize any of them, except one.
Master Glendinhook?
Greetings, Abbot Brahman.
Why are you out of St. Mirabel? Why are you here?
We are the Brothers Inquisitor. We've come to investigate claims of a miracle at Mount Ada performed by Avalyn Despris.
The building of the Chapel of Avalyn was halted by order of Father Abbot Agringare.
It would be foolish to expose ourselves in such a manner as to dedicate a new chapel. But the canonization of Brother Avalyn must go forward. A full investigation.
Why now?
The people need a hero at this dark time, would you not agree, Abbot Brahman? Perhaps Brother Avalyn will withstand the scrutiny of the process and become that hero.
It didn't make much sense to Brahman. He knew that Glendinhook was tied closely to Master Balray, certainly no friend to the memory of Avalyn Despris. At the College of Abbots, when Markwart had condemned Master Jojona for following Avalyn, Balray had been a huge supporter of Jojona's execution.
Let Avalyn's name be put forward, and let all the world rejoice.
But when he looked at Glendinhook's smile, Abbot Browman couldn't help but question the man's sincerity. Something just didn't seem right.
Abbot Hingis desires audience, my liege.
The castle guardsman spoke to King Danube. Duke Callus sat at the king's side.
Oh, Abbot Hingis.
Callus had no love for Hingis, the interim abbot of St. Hans, whom he thought a complete fool. Callus didn't care much for any member of the Abelican Church, of course. But in the case of Abbot Hingis, several others of King Danube's court, Constance among them, had to agree with him.
He has come to complain about the broken windows again, no doubt.
Constance Pemblebury, who had her back to the others, sat modestly and fed Torrance, her second son, who was now 6 months old. Merwick moved excitedly about her chair, setting up little wooden blocks then kicking them all over the room.
Or to talk about the weight of a soul and how it is lighter than the very air about us, and so it floats to heaven.
Your Majesty?
King Danube rolled his eyes.
No! Out with him! Out! Send him back to St. Hans and tell him to suffer the rocks and the taunts. Tell them all to suffer for the good of the world, and when they have finally appointed an abbot, a real abbot, let him come and beg audience with the king.
Better off is Jaoweth.
In the grave and at peace from Duke Callis. Did you wish to speak with the idiot?
No. Likely you did me a favor.
King Danube pulled himself from his chair and walked over to the window. Below him lay Ursel, quiet, awaiting winter. Every family had at least one victim now, so it was reported, and many houses lay dark and still, full of death, with no one to go in and retrieve the bodies. Such was King Danube's beloved capital that late autumn of God's year 829. It should have been among the happiest times of Danube's life. The demon and its minions had been shattered. The church, always a nagging rival to the throne, had been pushed into disarray, and his dear Constance had given him two sons, sons whom he was beginning to think of as heirs to his throne, though of course he'd have to speak with his brother at length about that possibility. Yet, here he was, buttoned up within the prison that Castle Ursel had become, a fortress against the misery of the plague, though that most insidious of enemies had found its way even into these fortified halls, forcing the expulsion of two servants and a guard. So far, though, none of his closest friends had been afflicted, and for that, King Danube mumbled a little prayer of thanks as he stood solemnly at the high window, looking out over his wounded kingdom. Not much of a blessing, perhaps, but in this dark day, any light at all seemed a good thing. The snow held off in the Northland until after the turn of winter, but when it did come to Dundalus, it did so in fury, with drifts covering the entire sides of houses and burying the fences of the corrals. Soon after, and still before the turn of God's year 830, the weather calmed enough for Pony to attempt venturing out. And truly she needed the time alone, at the Grove and Elbrian's Cairn, her great retreat from the events of the world. She saddled Greystone and walked out of Dundalus, up the north slope and along the rim of the vale filled with caribou moss and pines, for the edges of the dale were windblown and nearly clear, while the dell itself was deep in snow. She found the trails within the forest easier going than she had anticipated, and she soon made it to the sheltered grove. The rolling hills and sharp ravines nearby were too deep and too slick, so Pony dismounted again and tethered the horse in a windblown clearing, walking in the last quarter mile. Two sets of hoofprints, running the length of the last field and right into the grove, alerted her that she was not alone. At first, she thought it might be Bradwarden and Symphony, for who else would be out here on such a day? But then she saw a third track, the boots of a rider, beside the line of hoofprints. Shadowing the forest line for cover, Pony did a complete circuit of the grove. She spied a lone rider in the distance, sitting quietly along the tree line, bundled under mounds of furs. Now she fell into her hematite, using its depths to release her spirit from her corporeal body. Pony went out to the rider first, and determined on her way that he had a companion who was within the grove, her grove, and the mere thought of that made her angry. The rider was a man of about Pony's age, rugged but handsome, with a dark, two-week beard and sparkling, alert eyes. Something about him seemed familiar to Pony, but she couldn't place it. Not wanting to linger for fear of being discovered, she turned her spirit and swept into the grove, passing insubstantially among the trees. She found the other man standing before the twin cairns, grave markers that had been recently cleared of snow. He was a giant of a man, with long, somewhat thinning, flaxen hair, eyes the color of a clear northern sky, and a sword strapped diagonally across his back. And what a sword! The largest Pony had ever seen. A sword that could cleave through any blocking shield, through any blocking tree, and cut the opponent in half. Huh? The man glanced about, suddenly on the alert, and Pony realized that he had somehow sensed her presence. In the span of a single thought, she was back in her body, blinking her eyes, orienting herself to the physical world about her. She paused, waiting a few moments, and when no call came from the grove, and when the giant man didn't emerge, she picked a path that would keep her out of sight of the waiting rider, and slipped across the field, one hand on Defender, the other in her gemstone pouch, rolling both graphite and lodestone between her fingers. She moved stealthily from shadow to shadow, as Elbrine had taught her. She was now within 10 paces of the man.
You should not be sneaking up on me so, good woman. It makes me edgy.
The man turned slowly, a wry smile showing on his bearded face. His hands remained at his side, making no movement toward that incredible sword.
A bit far out of town in such a season as this, are you not?
What do you know of it?
I know that Dundalus is the closest town, and a hard morning's march in the snow. And I know that Weedy Meadow is another 20 miles from there.
Pony cocked her head, staring at him curiously. How could he know so much, without her being aware of any such man in the area? And what of Bradwarden? The centaur knew, or claimed to know, of everything that moved in the forest. And yet, Pony had not heard from Bradwarden in many days, and even that had been no more than the piping song carried on a favorable evening breeze.
What are you doing here?
Paying my respects.
To whom?
To fellow rangers.
Pony's jaw dropped.
To Nightbird, and to Maether before him. Word reached me of his demise, and so I owed him this visit, though the road was long and difficult.
Who are you?
I was thinking of asking you the same thing.
Who are you to stand uninvited and unannounced before my husband's grave?
Jilseponie Wyndon, then. Pony to her friends. Companion of Nightbird to the end. I am Andacanavar of Alpinador, elven trained, as was your husband. The full story of the tragedy in Palmaris came to me by the way of Brother Holand Delman of the Abelican Church, who now serves at St. Belfour in Vanguard.
Pony was shaking her head, hardly able to believe the man, but the mention of Brother Delman, her friend, put her at ease. Too much so, she realized a moment later, when she heard a voice behind her.
And I am Liam O'Blight.
Pony spun to see the man who'd been on horseback near her. Near enough to have jumped her before she could use her gemstones or draw her sword, and how foolish that made her feel. But this man bowed politely, respectfully, and made no move against her.
We did not know that you were again in this area, else we would have sought you out.
Though we plan on making as little contact with the folk of this region, or any other region outside Vanguard, as possible.
You would find that the folk of the Timberlands are not so quick to judge based on heritage.
Not that. We have heard news of the Rosy Plague.
True words.
And thus we do not wish to bring it with us back to Vanguard, or to Alpinador. But enough of my intrusions.
Pony realized that the ranger behind her had given the man a signal to be gone. He left with another bow, moving gracefully, with a warrior's balanced gait, and Pony turned back to regard the ranger. They talked easily, like old friends, for more than 2 hours. Pony did most of the talking, answering Andacanavar's many questions about Elbrion. The ranger wanted every detail of every story, wanted to hear Pony imitate her lover's laugh and describe his wry grin to the dimple. Andacanavar listened to her with obvious amusement, smiling and laughing often. How quickly the afternoon passed, and Pony realized that she would have to be on her way if she hoped to make Dundalus before dark.
The signs are telling me that tomorrow will be another fine day. Will you come back to this place then? And speak with me again?
Pony looked at him, seeming unsure.
I will tell you more about the elves, and more about that which helped to form your Nightbird into the man you loved.
Then I will return.
That night, in her bed, in the small room above Fellowship Way, Pony was visited by dreams of Elbrion, more vivid than any she had known since his death. Unlike some of her previous dreams of her husband, reenactments of that final battle mostly, these were pleasant, warm memories that made Pony awaken with a smile. She was up early, working quickly through her chores at the tavern, then promising Belster she would return by dark and rushing out. She found Andacanavar and his friend at the grove again, and again the smaller man left them. Untrue to his promise, though, Andacanavar bade Pony again to do the talking, to tell him even more of Nightbird. And she complied eagerly, pouring out her heart, telling about her separation from Elbrion and all those years apart, when he was with the elves and she in Palmaris, and later in the king's army. She told of their journey to the Barbican to do battle with the demon Dactyl, and Andacanavar liked that part most of all, and of their work against the minions of the demon upon their return south. She told of the journey to St. Mirabel to rescue Bradwarden. And then she told the Alpinadoran ranger, in solemn tones, tears streaking down her cheeks, of the final battle against Markwort, when Elbryon gave his life to save her and to rid the world of Bestis Bolzabar. When the sun began its swift descent, Pony realized that she had to go.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.